Hello, everybody. I'm Alexy Khrabrov, the organizer of SF Text. It's a new meetup about text mining, NLP, AI, search, and essential human intent behind the text. And this is our second meetup on the topic of topics and how do you classify content by topic. I have here with me Nemanja Spasojevic, director of software engineering at Lithium. And actually, we were formerly colleagues at Klout, where we worked on this similar set of technologies, and Klout is known for the standard of influence and classifying topics of influence on the web. So this is a very interesting area, and a lot of you guys probably are familiar with the technology. So we're very happy to be here at Lithium. Thanks for having us. It's great to have you with us. I want to ask you, what brought you to this domain, right? I know that you worked at Google before, at Google Books. Yep. Can you talk a little bit about what's interesting about this domain space?
Yeah, so I worked at Google Books for 6 years, and then after that I was looking for something smaller. Mm-hmm. But still I wanted to be able to have like similar impact like you have at Google, where you're working on the like a big scale data, and then like looking at many startups, like not too many. Many operate on the big data, but not like a really, really big data. So Klout was one of the only startups that actually operated on a kind of Twitter scale of the data, mm-hmm. and still was like a relatively small, like a tens like of the engineers. Mm-hmm. So that kind of interests me. And then the topical problems are very interested because you can start with the very simple things like build like a simple baseline, and then you can start to improve like and go as complex as you want. And always there is a challenge between academia and industry, where in academia you're trying to solve it for very high precision, you're trying to solve it to get into the core of the language itself, while in industry you're basically constrained with the limited resources, mm-hmm. and then like it's a kind of very, very interesting problem, right? Like there are two different sides of the problem.
I remember vividly, Klout was fairly constrained. So I wonder, at Google you have the support of all the engineers and all the infrastructure, right? And I think at Klout and Lithium, you guys did an amazing job by basically with a small team being able to ingest majority of the web content, right? And in my mind, this is a gigantic achievement which many people don't know, right? And don't realize that Klout has all this technology to essentially crawl the web. So can you talk a little bit more about how that became possible? And like, what is your scale? How much data you're actually ingesting?
Yeah, so at this moment, basically, Klout is digesting all of the Twitter public data, like mm-hmm. the mention stream, plus like all the data that users authorized us to collect, like from Facebook, Google+, LinkedIn, and basically some of the Wikipedia pages as well. Mm-hmm. And this scale, basically we process every day like about like 650 million new pieces of content. We were able to scale by basically efficiently implementing the collectors and mm-hmm. then harvesters, which normalize this data like in a generic fashion. Mm-hmm. And then on the algorithmic side, we were able to kind of hit a scale by taking some trade-offs between like using NLP mm-hmm. and using basically knowledge-based dictionary, mm-hmm. Knowledge-based dictionaries, which kind of give you like much faster speed, but you need to kind of cook them in advance and.
Okay, what is the balance? So, data scientists say that it's 80% is data munging and data wrangling, and only 20% is science, right? How is your time balance? Like, how much time do you spend on actually maintaining the systems and making sure they're up and running and performing? And how much time do you spend actually thinking of the science and kind of how do you improve the algorithm and how the algorithms perform?
Yeah, so if you ask me, it's mainly more like a 90-10 split, mm-hmm. because for a good science, you need to have a good engineering. So
right.
Being able to build a system which is very systematic in its nature, right? Mm-hmm. Where you're not scaling only for the volume of the data, but you're scaling for a number of different data sources, right? Mm-hmm. You're having a number of different social networks, and within each social network, you're having different kind of sources you can pull from, mm-hmm. from user actions to basically user graph or some other data sources, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And so, I mean, every data team essentially has engineers and data scientists, and there are different forms of collaboration. In some places, scientists just prototype things in MATLAB or Python, and then somebody has to take it to production. How do you guys manage this? Like, how do your data scientists interact with engineers? Is there this difference, or are they able to do different things?
So the average profile in my group, basically, it's like a very like a strong engineers with like a research focus.
Mm-hmm.
So there is no like separation between engineer and the scientist, right?
Mm-hmm.
Because if you kind of can develop like the smartest algorithm in the world, if it's very hard to get it into the production, or if the time to get it into production is pretty long,
mm-hmm.
like basically it doesn't cut it. This way, you know, like you engineer and you like do the research while doing it, kind of you're all the time at the edge of the production and
mm-hmm.
can kind of push more, iterate more, and it just like works. At least it worked for us.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I totally agree with this, right? So I think, like, you know, if you're kind of good enough to implement the best algorithms, it's probably learning software engineering practices and programming languages is probably an easier thing, right? So,
yeah.
But like, you have to set up a process. Do you guys use continuous deployment, continuous delivery, and testing? How do you make sure that your models are correct?
Yeah. So most, because like we use like a Hive mainly, right?
Mm-hmm.
So that helps quite a lot because like the data catalogization is solved for you.
Mm-hmm.
Then a lot of you're forced to implement all of your kind of scientific algorithms within the UDFs.
Mm-hmm.
So basically your scientific chunks are almost like modularized by that. And then the data transformation is trivial because that's what kind of Hive is. It's kind of SQL markup. So for us, that's how it was able to scale, basically.
Right, but when you develop new models and new algorithms,
yeah.
How do you make sure that they're correct? Like, do you test your algorithms?
So basically, like every day, like as things are running in production, you can very easily kind of like build your model. It sends you, let's say, like an email, hey, your Vika file is ready,
mm-hmm.
or basically your model is ready, and these are the weights, and you can trigger like a kind of parallel branch which executes like similar, like a same thing that would execute in a production, but under like a dev namespace. So
okay.
Basically, you're always able to run like, you know, like a 5 experiments and still be able to run like your kind of production daily.
Okay. Interesting. So I think we've seen a great evolution of, you know, of cloud score and influence and topic understanding, and you've been iterating on this. So where, like, what are the next avenues? Like, how do you see your algorithms improve? Where are your future directions?
Yeah. So I think like on the topical side, like basically we saw like a problem of topical assignment and
mm-hmm.
topical expertise. And so far we were like very heavy like on the English side.
Mm-hmm.
And now like that Klout became like a part of the Lithium, which is like international company.
Mm-hmm.
Like the next focus is basically being able to scale up for like European languages,
mm-hmm.
like in Arab languages and
interesting.
So,
how are you going to solve the, like, you need to evaluate relevance and
yeah.
precision. How are you
yeah.
going to do that?
So first, by not committing to any kind of quality for the foreign languages. But joke on the side, like, because our approach is heavily based on the knowledge-based dictionaries,
mm-hmm.
like, which are already kind of, like, international in their nature.
Mm-hmm.
Like, we hope, like, to leverage that kind of to be able to scale it for the multilingual corpora.
Okay, and you know, I'm also running a Subscala meetup, and you guys are on JVM, so I'm always interested in advancing data science on the JVM. So, and I wonder from your perspective, right, where do you see data science on JVM going? How can we make scientific computing on JVM easier, and how can we invite people who do R and Python, you know, as kind of JVM people? How can we make sure that it's a first-class platform for scientific computing?
Yeah, so I'm pretty biased about this, and if you ask me, I wouldn't even use the Java or JVM.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I would use like C++, and it's something where actually you kind of have better control over the memory,
mm-hmm.
and like it's faster processing and stuff like that. So probably not the best person
okay.
to talk about.
Cool. Yeah. That's from the Google experience.
Yeah.
They just open sourced MR for C, I think, the framework for
oh, yeah.
produced,
so
but that's not the original Google framework. Well, and okay, and so so basically you've been, you know, in this startup world for a few years. So how does that compare, like, you know, an ability to run this web scale frameworks at Lithium and versus Google? I mean, can you speak about, like, you know, does it become manageable, right? Can you do more with fewer people? Like, what is the difference between these two settings?
Yeah, I think definitely, like, it's easier to iterate faster just because, like, it's a smaller company, it's a smaller team. You're bounded by the resources, but sometimes that's just, like, the better thing because then you kind of have to think, like, in a different ways. A lot of problems haven't been solved for you. Mm-hmm. Like there have been, like, in a Google, which has, like, a pretty good, like, a good tool set, mm-hmm. and a lot of utilities that have been developed. So basically, it's more challenging, but again, it, like, gives you more opportunity to innovate and kind of do things your own way, basically.
Cool. Well, thanks for sharing with us, and we're looking forward to your talk at Meetup tonight and the Text by the Bay conference in April. April 24 and 25 at Galvanize, text.bythebay.io. We hope to see you guys there.
Thanks. Thank you for having me here.